Is increasing reactive oxygen species a good strategy for appetite control? Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind, or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Philippa says, there's a lot of talk in the low-carb world about how stearic acid is the best fatty acid due to it promoting mitochondrial reactive oxygen species, leading to cellular insulin resistance and hence satiety signaling downstream from that effect. However, I understand that stearic acid beta oxidation also produces more ATP. So would it be true to say that the reactive oxygen species created are just proportionate to the amount of ATP created? Do you think we can categorize fatty acids as better or worse in any respect in regards to mitochondrial reactive oxygen species generation? I'm not sure I entirely understood this. So there's talk about how stearic acid is the best fatty acid because it promotes mitochondrial reactive oxygen species and cellular insulin resistance, and hence satiety. So I'm not exposed to these arguments, but I don't think that mitochondrial reactive oxygen species and insulin resistance is the proper way that you want to induce satiety. And now, granted, I'm very much on board with the idea that reactive oxygen species play important roles in cell signaling. That's undoubtedly true. But that doesn't change the fact that they are a liability to cause damage. And in fact, I personally believe that one of the main reasons that reactive oxygen species play a role in cell signaling is because the signaling is designed to limit that liability. I have the antioxidant course for free at chrismasterjohnphd.com/antioxidant, and in the master class you all have special features including transcripts with slides embedded and stuff like that. If you go under my products, you have to click forward one or two pages, but the antioxidant system course is there. And I go through my working model of how this stuff works. But basically, if you generate more reactive oxygen, so basically all metabolism generates some reactive oxygen species in the mitochondria, all of it. And there are two, it's sort of a double-edged sword. So on the one hand, more reactive oxygen species could very quickly cause very bad damage to the mitochondrial membrane and to all the, if it leaks out of the mitochondria, all the other cellular membranes. That's why you have a whole antioxidant system designed for that damage control with vitamin E, even we were just talking about ferritin. Even ferritin is really part of that system to sequester iron, because if the mitochondria generates superoxide, gets converted to hydrogen peroxide, if there's free iron there, it reacts with iron to produce the hydroxyl radical. But both hydrogen peroxide and just more so the hydroxyl radical, if they reach a PUFA in the cell membrane, will oxidize it. And if vitamin E is not there, that will lead to a lipid peroxidation chain reaction that basically destroys the whole membrane. In fact, in vitamin E deficiency, in a severe deficiency, you have hemolytic anemia because if the lipids oxidize the membrane, the membrane falls apart. So red blood cells just fall apart because of lipid peroxidation chain reactions in the cell membrane. So any level of reactive oxygen species is very much a threat of oxidative damage. it doesn't necessarily cause a lot of oxidative damage because we have an antioxidant defense system. And part of that system is damage control, like vitamin E. The other part of that system is a whole cell signaling infrastructure designed to create feedback loops to minimize oxidative damage. So I think to one of the feedback loops is that if you have more input to the mitochondria, or you have a decreased ability for the mitochondria to handle that energy input load, you will have more reactive oxygen species. So in general, there's what you could say, there's a tone of reactive oxygen species at the mitochondrial level, where it's just there's always a certain small percentage of oxygen that is turned into superoxide, which is then converted into hydrogen peroxide, instead of being converted to water for full production of ATP. And then that tone adjusts, right? So there's, if you have deficit in the electron transport chain that prevents you from fully handling the incoming energy, reactive oxygen species go up. Similarly, if you have a greater input beyond what it's able to handle, reactive oxygen species goes up. And so what is the effect of that? Well, more reactive oxygen species then shuts down the input of energy. Doesn't matter if it's because there's too much energy or if it's because we can't handle it. Either way, if there's some deficit between the incoming energy and what you can handle burning, reactive oxygen species will shut down fatty acid. They'll shut down I don't know if they act on carnitine, but they act on the pores and the outer mitochondrial membrane, shut down fatty acid input into the membrane. And they act on glucose transporters to shut down glucose input into the cell. Is that going to cause satiety in the brain? Maybe. I haven't studied that. I think Stephan Guyenet would be a great person to talk to about that. He knows much more about satiety mechanisms in the brain than I do. It wouldn't surprise me in the sense that if you want to shut down energy coming into the cell, why wouldn't you also want at some bigger level to shut down energy input into the body? I guess that makes sense. But I've mostly studied this in the case of outside the brain, peripherally. What is it doing? And what it's doing in adipose tissue or in skeletal muscle is it's shutting down glucose uptake, leading to hyperglycemia, and it's shutting down fatty acid uptake into the mitochondria, leading to elevated free fatty acid levels, all of which are generally harmful to the body. Now, this is an adaptive, desirable thing, because let's say you have a trillion cells, if it's only 50,000 of them that can't handle the energy load, and they stop taking up glucose and they stop taking up fatty acids, that doesn't necessarily cause hyperglycemia or elevated free fatty acids, because those energy levels, if they couldn't get into 50,000 of the cells, they have the other rest of a trillion. So it's really only when the preponderance of the cells are all signaling in that way that you get hyperglycemia or elevated free fatty acids. You know, but the thing is, like, yes, you can look at that and you can say, well, this is about balancing energy metabolism. And I think it works out that way. But I doubt that it evolved because of selective pressure to prevent body fatness. I mean, in particular, I'm pretty sure that, you know, why did Rob Wolf name his book Wired to Eat? Or look at Stefan's The Hungry Brain, or look at, you know, I believe everyone who has thought about this has opined that human beings evolved to seek energy in a world where energy was, you know, where famine was a much greater risk than being fat. And so I think, you know, the risk of obesity is very much a modern context that most people, and I think this is correct, most people thinking about it from the perspective of, we did not evolve to be able to handle constant access to the most delicious food. And so if we're constantly surrounded by the most delicious food and must sacrifice nothing to get it, then due to the wiring that we had evolutionarily, we will be biased towards eating too much and getting fat. So I don't think that reactive oxygen species evolved as signaling molecules to regulate energy balance, because if they weren't there, we'd get fat. I don't think that jives at all with the general theme that we actually did evolve to seek out energy-dense foods to counter the risk of famine. So why did it evolve? Well, what happens when you remove antioxidant protection? You know, if you don't shut down energy input into the mitochondria in response to reactive oxygen species, then what happens? You get more reactive oxygen species. And what happens when you get more reactive oxygen species? Same thing that happens when you remove antioxidants. They will oxidize the lipid membranes. The lipid membranes will fall apart and you will completely lose functionality of the cell. So I think that, you know, it's an interesting hypothesis that you want satiety via reactive oxygen species. But, and I'd have to confirm this with Stephan or with someone else who's really in this area, I believe that reactive oxygen species probably, I believe they're thought to play a role actually in leptin resistance, in central leptin resistance, which probably plays a role in adiposity rather than more so than satiety. But putting that aside, you know, it's an interesting hypothesis that you want more reactive oxygen species to get more satiety. I overwhelmingly do not believe that it's correct. And so I'm not familiar with this argument, but if stearic acid promotes more mitochondrial ROS, then I don't think that that's an argument for getting more stearic acid. Now, Philippa's continues that question. However, I understand that stearic acid beta oxidation also produces more ATP. So would it be true to say that the ROS created are just proportionate to the amount of ATP created? So I haven't dug into stearic acid in the mitochondria recently, so I'm not sure what mechanism that they're referring to. But it, generally, ROS is not necessary. It's not, although it might loosely be correlated with the amount of ATP produced in the sense of, you know, when the primary variation is coming from variation in energy input. You know, for example, over the course of the fasting feeding cycle, you probably have ROS correlating with ATP because when energy inputs go down, ROS goes down and ATP goes down. However, in the context of varying the different types of energy inputs or different other contextual factors, all in the course of isocaloric fed state metabolism, you generally are going to have a negative correlation between ATP produced and ROS produced, because generally the ROS is produced exactly as a result of incomplete metabolism. So the more completely you harness the energy from NADH and FADH2, the more ATP you will produce and the less ROS you'll produce, because oxygen will be fully converted to water instead of being converted to superoxide. But the less completely you harness the energy from NADH and FADH2, the less ATP you will produce because you extracted less energy. And because oxygen was not fully converted to water, it was converted to superoxide. And so I don't think that it would just be from producing more ATP. I think you would produce either more ATP and less ROS or less ATP and more ROS when you're specifically talking about varying things in isocaloric fed state metabolism. And then the final question is, do I think we can categorize fatty acids as better or worse in any respect in regards to mitochondrial ROS generation? That I'm going to decline to answer because I haven't kept up with the literature on which fatty acids generate more ROS in the mitochondria. But I will say that having excess PUFA in the cell membranes from consuming PUFA over and above the nutritional requirement is a liability, where the more ROS you produce, the more damage you'll make to the membrane. So that would be my one comment on that as an indirect question. Okay, thank you, Philippa, for your question.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount. For the remainder of 2020, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.